Hey, welcome back to Drowning in Yarn. I'm Caleb. I'm so excited right now because I finished a sweater. That may not seem like a big deal. I've knit a lot of sweaters, but it's been a while since I finished one. I've had this mental block about knitting fitted garments for a while because of the pandemic. My body has changed. I don't go anywhere. So I feel like, where would I wear them? It's led me to having this complete loss of motivation about finishing the two sweaters that I've had on my needles for a really long time, or what feels like a really long time. But this sweater, the Forbes by Jared Flood, has changed that all for me. I love everything about it, from the design to the fit that I achieved to the yarn that I used. So if you want to hear about my journey with this sweater, then stick around. I just want to remind you, as usual, if you're enjoying this video while you're watching it, please hit that little like button down below. And if you want to hear about more of my projects in the future, more tips and knitting and yarn related things, I would love if you hit that little subscribe button so you can see what I have coming up in the future. I started this Forbes sweater in the first half of September 2020, and I just truly finished it on March 4th, 2021. That's about 6 months, and it's the longest I've ever spent knitting a sweater. I saw the Forbes sweater pattern sometime early last year, and it immediately checked all the boxes for me. It is a simple yoke sweater with a very classic design, and the yoke texture is just knits and purls. There's nothing complex about it. Because it was designed as part of Brooklyn Tweed's Ranch Specific Release Ranch 02 Forbes, the sweater samples were knit in that yarn. So because I loved all the samples so much and all the pattern pictures, I knew that if I was gonna knit it, I wanted to knit it in Ranch 02. But I won't lie to you, it's a pricey yarn. At $16 for a 102-yard skein, I didn't know that I was going to be able to do justice to that kind of expenditure on a single sweater. So I second-guessed myself until August of last year, when Brooklyn Tweed had their virtual tent sale. Now, I'll just back up really quickly and say, I think this yarn is worth every penny of its typical price, but that doesn't change the fact that it was a lot of money to commit to one project. So I waited. And then that Brooklyn Tweed tent sale came around, and I had a $50 gift card for my birthday sitting in my inbox, and the yarn was on sale. It was available in this color, burdock, for around $6 a skein. There were various colors of Ranch 02 in the tent sale that were either overstock or seconds. So when I saw this color at that price, I knew that it was time to knit the Forbes sweater, and I snatched up a sweater quantity. Now, because I had that $50 gift card and the yarn was only $6, I bought 14 skeins for $84 and only spent $34 out of my own pocket. It was a steal. So shortly after I got the yarn, I bought the pattern and realized, because I hadn't really thought about it too much before, that it was a bottom-up sweater. And I don't love knitting bottom-up sweaters. I like to knit them top-down because it makes me feel more comfortable that I'm gonna achieve the right length on the body and the sleeves. And I also taper all my sweaters in the body to just give me a better fit for my own body. And that's a little bit easier, I think, for me to try on and make sure I get right if I'm knitting it top-down. So I thought back to something my friend Grace mentioned about doing this hybrid construction, where you sort of do bottom-up for the yoke and top-down for the rest of the sweater. And I chatted with her about it. You can check out that episode from last September. I walked through all the steps that I'm planning to go through, the provisional cast on and all my swatching. And all of that led to a product that I love. Grace is a genius, and that technique worked so well. But along the way, I took these really long breaks, like these long pauses for various reasons, and I let the sweater grow into this like stressful thing in my mind at some point. I first took this really long break whenever it was time to pick up the live stitches from the provisional cast on and start knitting down. I did that and it was not bad. Then I started knitting the body, and for some reason, I took a break doing that. Then I moved and it came time to finish the body and bind it off. I decided to do 2x2 ribbing instead of the ribbing that was in the pattern. It occurred to me that it might be really nice to do a tubular bind off. So I looked up a tutorial. I found this super interesting technique where you do a couple setup rows and then you put all of your knits on one needle and all of your purls on another needle. You hold them parallel to each other and then you Kitchener stitch it closed, sort of like the toe of a sock. The only problem was that that technique was for 1x1 ribbing, but the tutorial said it would work for 2x2, you just rearrange the knits and the purls. So I thought, no big deal, and I did that. The problem was that it was a little bit tight. So then I set it aside and I didn't think about it. A little bit later, I picked it up, I knit the sleeves, I did the same bind off. When I went to put it on that first time when it was done, the bind off snapped. So I thought, no big deal, I will fix it. And then I set it aside again because that became this stressful thing. And when I picked it back up to fix the bind off, I noticed that it snapped in two places. It just wasn't stretchy enough to go around my shoulders, and the bind off just didn't hold up. I think it's a great bind off, but not for this project. So this week, after letting it sit again, I picked it up, I put my needle into a row of stitches, a few rows just above the bind off. I cut the bind off, knit a couple rounds, and did Elizabeth Zimmerman's sewn bind off, and it was perfect. Somewhere along the way, this project that had turned into this huge mental block just all came together, and I loved it from the moment I put it on. I think it's really important to kind of make it clear what my frame of mind was during this whole process. This project had sort of taken on a life of its own. It became this really big mental hurdle for me. It sort of just sat around my house as this like unfinished project that was taunting me. It just became an obligation to me. No matter how much I loved the pattern from the beginning, no matter how enjoyable it was to knit with the yarn, it just felt like something I had to do. Now, I also thought that it would be really helpful to just leave it on the table where I would see it and think, oh, now's a good time to work on it. But that just sort of made it always visible and made me always aware of how it wasn't finished. Even when it was sort of done and I just needed to fix the bind off, it sat there unfinished and needed to be done. And it just became a source of stress. Instead of a project that I love and that brought me comfort during this really stressful time. Now, I should also mention that this whole time, I had another sweater, my Cozy Classic Raglan, which if you've been watching me for a while, you know that that sweater has kind of lingered and it needs a little bit of sweater surgery due to a miscalculation on my part about the yoke depth. It just doesn't fit the way that I want and needs to be fixed. And all of that mixed with the pandemic and us moving in the middle of it just zapped my motivation to knit sweaters, but it's back. I'm so happy with my modifications to this garment, and it feels so me. I think the odd construction that I used to knit this garment really, really worked out. There's a slight tension issue where I picked up the stitches from the provisional cast on. You can really kind of see that if you're looking for it. I don't think most people will. And the stitch columns are off by about a half a stitch. But to me, those issues are not deal breakers. It is worth it for me to be able to knit a bottom-up sweater as a top-down sweater, since that process is just so much more enjoyable to me. I also am super happy with my gauge. I gauge swatched 3 times, which is a lot for me, and I think that the density of the fabric came out just right. It's drapey and warm, but it doesn't feel dense. It's substantial, but it doesn't feel stiff. And the size that I got is perfect. It's fitted, but it's still roomy enough to feel cozy and comfortable. And this yarn really helps that cozy feeling. So I mentioned that the yarn is pricey, and I'll tell you why I think that the price is super fair and why I would not hesitate to buy a sweater quantity again at full price. Brooklyn Tweed is just super transparent in general about where their wool comes from and the process that it goes through to become yarn. And this Rancho 2 takes it to the next level. All of this yarn is from the Forbes Ranch in Casey, Wyoming. It's 100% Rambouillet that is taken to a mill called Crescent Woolen in Two Rivers, Wisconsin, where it's spun into a 3-ply woolen spun yarn. Then it's dyed in Philly at Caledonian Dye Works. Now, I didn't have to go to their website or do any research to find this. It's written right on the label of every skein of yarn. I have been wanting to learn more about the materials that I work with, and having this kind of transparency, knowing exactly where it comes from, feels so awesome. It's also really important to note that it's 100% American wool. I've been reading a lot of Clara Park's books. The last book of hers that I read was Vanishing Fleece, where she purchased a bale of wool and went through the process of turning it into yarn so that she could follow along that journey from, you know, sheep to skein. And she did this all with American producers. And if you read that book, you'd know that that's a challenge because the American wool industry is sort of a dwindling industry. So for Brooklyn Tweed to have this commitment to doing that and to be able to purchase yarn where I know all the steps that I took. I know that that is something that's worth some money because it's not easy. But having knit with this yarn and being able to wear it, I can also tell you that it's 100% worth it if you have the means to afford it. It is amazing. And it's really timely that I finished this sweater just this week because like the day after I finished it, I opened my email and saw that Brooklyn Tweed is launching Ranch 03 this month. And that's gonna be a merino wool from a ranch in Colorado that's owned by a woman named Julie Hansmeyer. The fact that I know that is so cool. And all of this is sort of coming together for me as I've kind of gone on this little journey to know more about wool and know more about the fibers that I'm working with. I just got an e-spinner and I started learning to spin yarn. And I picked up this really cool book called The Fleece and Fiber Sourcebook that has over 200 different types of fiber and tells you a little bit about their history and about how they react to dye and how they are spun. So because I just finished this sweater and I know all this information about where it came from, I decided to look in the Fleece and Fiber Sourcebook to learn a little bit more about Rambouillet. The book says that Rambouillet is in the Merino family, sort of a cousin of the Merino sheep, and that they came to America in the mid 1800s where they did sort of well as a hardy breed because they flock together. So where some breeds of sheep will apparently disperse to sleep, Rambouillet tend to gather to sleep. In numbers, they have greater protection from predators, which made them last a little longer. And it also goes on to mention that their fibers have all of the softness of merino, but have more elasticity and bounce because the fibers have more crimp to them and they're a little bit longer. So it doesn't have like that luxurious merino feel to it, but it has all of the softness. It's loftier, has more elasticity, it holds more air, which is a great insulator, so it's warm but not heavy. And all of these properties are super obvious in this blocked fabric. This sweater is substantial but drapey. It's light, it's comfortable, it breathes. It's also really soft, but it has that rustic woolly wool feel to it at the same time. And that's my favorite kind of wool. So all of this has just been a really long way to say that my sweater knitting motivation is back. I'm so excited to cast on my next sweater. I already know what it's gonna be. And as a bonus, I have all the yarn in my stash already. So all I have to buy is the pattern and I'll be able to get it started. I have a few test knits that I have coming up and there's a couple more hats I have to knit for my Level Up in 2021 knit along, which runs until March 20th if you haven't already joined or you wanna knit another hat. But I can't wait to knit my next sweater. So if you wanna stick around and see what that sweater is gonna be, please hit that little subscribe button down below and the bell next to it to get notifications when I post new videos. I hope you do and I hope you stick around to see what I have coming up. And if you enjoyed this video, hit that little like button down below. Leave a comment. I love to hear from you. Let me know how your motivation with knitting is going. I feel like mine during this pandemic has had some ups and some downs, but all along the way, I found some project that's been a comfort rather than a stress, even when others are stressing me out. Anyway, I'm gonna go knit those test knits and knit those hats. Until next time, I hope you enjoy your knitting and I will see you later.